Consciousness the way to fruition in sex, excerpt from Marriage, Mysteries and Dimensions Beyond. Consciousness is the only way to be in life. Through consciousness alone, matter, lust and energy and all that is gross and even acts are transformed. If you are conscious, then matter, lust and all that is gross and even the acts are transformed. Sex in its present form is gross. It needs to be transformed. It is a baser metal. Through consciousness, just as when you put the baser metal into the fire, then it attains to purity. Gold has many impurities when it is mined, when it is put in the fire, in the furnace, it attains to its optimum purity. So too sex, as you know, is nothing else but a baser energy that has been just mined from the being of the ocean. It needs to go through the process in order to attain to its purity. And its purest form, it becomes compassion. In its grossest form, it is lust. It is the source of jealousy, anger, frustration and all that is negative in life. The moment it goes through the furnace of consciousness, or awareness, then it attains to its purity. Then even the acts are transformed. As you know, sex to you is an act, not the energy. So when you are aware, even the acts get transformed. And you attain the higher realms of consciousness, the realm of bliss and harmony. Know this as the orgasmic experience through sex to attain beyondness. Matter is energy. And energy cannot be destroyed. Only form of energy changes from gross to subtle. Modern physics has discovered one of the greatest things ever, and that is, this is the contribution of Albert Einstein to humanity. Energy is equal to mc square. Matter only appears, and there is no such thing as matter because nothing is solid. Even the solid rock is nothing but pulsating energy. Even the solid rock is as much fluid-like energy as the roaring ocean. The waves are arising in the solid rock, but these cannot be seen because they are subtle. Waves are arising in you constantly, but you cannot see. Waves of lust, waves of sex are constantly arising in you, but you cannot see because this is somewhat subtle. When you see the waves in the ocean, you can see it because it is visible. The waves that are arising in the solid rock cannot be seen because they are very subtle. But the rock too is waving, pulsating and breathing. And it is alive. However, the movement is so subtle that mind cannot capture it. Friedrich Nietzsche has declared that God is dead. He is mistaken. God is not dead. On the contrary, matter is dead. And more precisely, matter is not dead either. Something dies only if it exists as matter. And you remember the science, the physics has proved that matter is not matter, instead it is energy. Matter has been found not to exist at all. What exists in reality is energy. This insight into matter brings modern physics very close to mysticism. For the first time, the scientists and the mystics are coming very close to one another. Mystics have always maintained that consciousness is. Man exists as consciousness alone. Man is nothing but ever-expanding consciousness. Such is the understanding of the sages and the mystics from times immemorial. Addington, Sir Arthur Stanley Addington, a British astrophysicist of the 20th century, discovered the Addington limit, the natural limit to luminosity of stars, or the radiation generated by accretion into compact object, and it is named in his honor. He is famous for his work regarding the theory of relativity, which he explained to the British speaking world. Although theory of relativity is connected with Albert Einstein, but it was Stanley Addington who is famous for his work regarding the theory of relativity, because it was he who explained this theory to English speaking world. He also conducted an expedition to observe the solar eclipse of 29th of May 1919, the famous solar eclipse that provided one of the earliest confirmations of relativity, and he became known for his popular exposition and interpretations of the theory. As one of the greatest scientists of the age, he said, "We used to think that matter is a thing. We used to think that matter is a thing. Now it is no more so. Matter is more like thought than like matter is more like a thought than like a thing. Entire existence is energy. That alone exists. Science has discovered that observed is energy. Whatever you observe is energy. The object is energy. At least for 5,000 years it has been known that the other polarity, the subject, the observer, or consciousness is energy. Indeed, consciousness is energy. Consciousness is fluid-like. That is why it goes on expanding. If it was solid, then it cannot expand. A simple thing. It continues to expand because it is fluid-like. That is why it goes on expanding. It is dynamic and constantly moving. So too, your body is energy, your mind is energy, and your soul too is energy. Then what is the difference between these three? The difference is only of a different rhythm and different wavelength. Body is gross. Through body, energy functions in a gross way, and as a result, it is visible. You can only see things that are visible. At the level of the body, there is lust. There are actions emerging out of lust. And the actions that emerge out of lust is your so-called sex acts. These can be encompassed as sex. Very simple and easy to understand. At the level of the body, there is the energy of lust. And all the actions that emerge out of lust are known as, or can be categorized as, sex acts. Contrary to body, mind is relatively more subtle, but is still not too subtle. You can close your eyes and you can see the thoughts moving on the inner sky. Thoughts can be seen. They are not as visible as your body. Your body is visible to everybody else. human body is publicly visible, your thoughts are private and remain visible to you alone. Whatever is going on in your mind, only you can visualize it. No one else can visualize it. Nobody can see your thoughts. Only you can see them, or people who have worked very deeply into seeing thoughts. There is an entire science of it, how to see the thoughts. But ordinarily, they are not visible to others. The third is the ultimate layer inside you, and that is of consciousness. It is not even visible to you. It cannot be reduced to an object. Instead, it remains the subject ever. When all the three layers of energy, when all these three layers of energy function in harmony with one another, when all these three layers of energies function in harmony with one another, you are healthy and whole. If these energies do not function in harmony and accord, you are ill and unhealthy. You are no more whole, and to be whole is to be holy, and to be whole is to be healthy. When these three layers are in harmony, functioning as an orchestra, then the fourth, the transcendence, evolves out of this innerness. As a master, my effort is to discover ways and means to help you so that your body, mind, and consciousness all can dance in one rhythm, in togetherness, and in deep harmony, not in any conflict, instead in deep cooperation. The moment your body, mind, and consciousness function together, you have become the Trinity, and that experience of being Trinity is God. When it is said God is Trinity, according to Christian understanding, it is Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. According to Hindus, it is Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. But this is where it creates the ritualistic way of life. Energy functioning at the level of body, at the level of mind, and at the level of consciousness function together in harmony, in deep harmony, then you have become the Trinity. And that experience of the three energies working in harmony with one another is God. Therein all experiences of the body and mind dissolve to attain organic, orgasmic experience of oneness. Therein all energies, therein all and experiences of the body, mind, dissolve to attain to orgasmic experience of oneness. This is God, as you may call, but I will call it godliness. There is no relation between consciousness and energy. Instead, consciousness itself is energy, the purest energy. Mind is not so pure, and body is still less pure. Body is much too mixed, and mind also is not pure energy. This is why body is gross, baser, and all the acts that come through the body and the mind, they are to be transformed through consciousness. These acts can be transformed and transcended. The act of sex is a function of body and mind. When it happens consciously, Meditatively, it is transformed. Remember, consciousness is totally pure energy. But you can know this consciousness only if you make a cosmos out of the three and not a chaos. But as such as your energies are at the level of the body, the lust, at the level of mind, thoughts about lust, they are all in a state of chaos. There is no deep understanding about these phenomena of energy at the level of body, the phenomena of lust, the phenomena of thoughts regarding lust and sex. That is why there is chaos. People are living in chaos and inner conflict. On the other hand, there is body and its energies. Their bodies say one thing and want to go in one direction. Minds are completely oblivious of the needs of the body. For centuries you have been taught that you are not the body and body is your enemy. People who are against sex, they condemn body. But if you condemn the outer dimension of the temple, how can you enter the inner realm of it? Minds are completely oblivious of the body. For centuries you have been taught that you are not the body and body is your enemy. But you remember, in reality you are neither the body nor the mind. Instead you are consciousness. But this understanding of Shankar, when he said in Himalayas at the age of 8, when he met Govindapad Acharya, he asked him, "Who are you?" Then he composed Atma Shatkam, a composition of 6 stanzas known as Atma Shatkam. Mano Buddhi Ankar Chittani Naham. Mano Buddhi, man means mind, buddhi means intellect. Mano Buddhi Ahankar. Ahankar means ego, chit means the inner faculty of the mind. Mano Buddhi Ankar Chittani Naham. Naham, I am neither these. These are the 4 aspects of the mind. The body, mano, man. Man is an aspect of mind also. In another explanation on Nirvana Shatkam, I had explained this. And this video is available on YouTube as Atma Shatkam or Nirvana Shatkam. You are neither of these, but you are consciousness. And he says, Mano Buddhi Ankar Chittani Naham. Then in the last says, my nature is Chidananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham. My nature is ever blissful consciousness. Minds are completely oblivious of the body. For centuries you have been taught that you are not the body and body is your mind. You are taught that you have to fight with it. You are taught to fight constantly with your body and destroy it, because body is sin. This is why there are certain sects of religion who consider sex as sin. Christians do. There are other sects too who consider it as sin. How can body be sin? Body is the temple for the shrine of the being. Body is the outer dimension of the shrine. Also, body is the instrument of perception and action. Through body, you enter into actions. It is the instrument of perception and action. Through the instrument of the body, through the organs of perception, you hear, you see, you touch, you feel, you smell, you taste. These are the sense organs which bring constantly the perception of the outer world. And when the information that comes to you through these organs of perception, it is processed in the state of harmony, then your actions are harmonious. Also, remember, the body is the instrument of perception and action. It must receive instructions from somewhere else. There is a power within that knows beyond your knowing, and that is the energy of the consciousness. You are listening to me, but you are not seeing. If someone comes with you and listens to these words, he may want to know, who is this person talking? But to you, there is no confusion, there is no conflict in that whose voice is this. You are familiar with the voice of Tao Sho Buddha. You know it is Tao Sho Buddha is speaking. There is no confusion or conflict. Because in you, the instructions comes from somewhere else when you hear this voice. The moment you hear this voice, the instruction comes from somewhere else that confirms that yes, this is the voice of Tao Sho Buddha. But one who is not familiar, his instructions is not coming from somewhere beyond, he does not know. He will inquire whose voice is this. There are traditions that condemn body as the sinner. When Adam sinned for the first time, it is propagated that it was body that sinned. But what is that prompted Adam to go that way? To go to that forbidden tree? Nobody meditates over. What is that prompted Adam to go to that forbidden tree? We could not see that which prompted him. Certainly we can see the feet moving towards the tree. Then maybe he had to tiptoe to reach the fruit, and the hands were used to pick the fruits. Human eye can only see the gross, and then out of ignorance goes on blaming the gross for the sin. And this is the understanding world over. Human eye can only see the gross, and then out of ignorance goes on blaming the gross for the sin. We must go to the cause behind the effect. Body is simply the instruments of perception and action. Gross is vulnerable. We must go to the cause behind the gross, behind the actions. Body is gross and therefore easy to be blamed and punished. Gross is energy, and energy is innocent. Such things are harmful and poisonous. But these have been taught for so long that they have become part of your collective mind, collective understanding. Such conditioning is there, and as a result, you do not experience your body in a rhythmic dance with the consciousness that you are. Such conditioning is there. And as a result, you do not experience your body in a rhythmic dance. Dance with consciousness that you are. I emphasize on dancing, music, song, and celebration. I emphasize on dancing, music, song, and celebration. Because it is only in dance that you will feel that your body, your mind, and you are functioning together. The body, mind, and you, the consciousness, are functioning together. That is why Sufi whirling is there. Rumi danced for 36 hours. The body was whirling, but he became aware of the unmoving or the subtle movement of the consciousness within. Rumi danced. People came to see a great Sufi dancing. They came, they watched him for a few hours, went back home, take a rest, and came back again to see him. But Rumi continued dancing for 36 hours. The body was whirling, but he became aware of the unmoving or the subtle movement of consciousness within. And in that state, Rumi attained to enlightenment because he became aware of that which does not move within the axle. All the movements takes place on the axle, but axle itself does not move. The joy is infinite when all these function together and the richness is great, indescribable. Consciousness is the highest form of energy, and when all the three energies function together through an act, the fourth happens. Now, it does not matter with this whether this act is sex or meditation or anything else. Anytime when all the three function in harmony with one another through any act or thought or understanding, the fourth, which is transcendence, naturally happens. That is why when you go into the act of sex, which is the gross at the level of the body, singing and dancing and meditating, there is complete harmony within. And with that harmony, when all the three energies function together as an orchestra, the fourth happens on its own. The fourth is always present when these three function together. When these three function as an organic unity, fourth is always there, is still invisible but functioning. Fourth dimension is nothing but the organic unity. This is what the Hindu concept, Hindus call it as Turiya, the fourth dimension. Gurdjieff called it as fourth dimension. When all the three energies, the gross, the mind, all these and the consciousness, means you are going in the act of, which is act through the body, but your mind rationalizes and understands this, there is instruction coming from the higher source, which is consciousness, then there is harmony. In the East, we have called that fourth simply the fourth or Turiya, which is transcendence. We have not given it any name. The three have names, but the fourth is nameless. To know the fourth is to know godliness. Or in your language, to know the fourth is to know more precisely God is when you are an organic, orgasmic unity. God is not when you are a chaos, disunity and conflict. When your house is divided against yourself, there is no God. When you are undivided, exist as organic, orgasmic unity, there is God. When you are tremendously happy with yourself, happy as you are, blissful as you are, grateful as you are, and all your energies are dancing together, then you are an orchestra or synergism of all the energies. God is. Godliness surrounds. When you are tremendously happy with yourself, happy as you are, nothing is given to you, yet still you are happy for no reason. You have not won the lottery. Look at the baby, a child is happy. The child has not won any lotto or any lottery. The child has not achieved any university degree or honors, yet still the child is blissful. When you are tremendously happy with yourself, happy as you are, nothing is given to you, you have not won any laurels, yet still you are happy. Blissful as you are, grateful as you are, and all your energies are dancing together, you are an orchestra or synergism of your energies. Godliness surrounds you. You are embodiment of God. Then God is not sitting somewhere as has been conceived by you or infused into you, into your mind, that God is sitting somewhere else. Then you are an orchestra or synergism of all your energies. Godliness surrounds you. In that state, in whatever act, be it sex or anything else, it will take you beyond. In that state, in whatever act, be it sex, you enter, it will take you beyond. And then one day, when you reach the ultimate, you are transformed. Meditatively, when you enter sex out of your inner harmony, you certainly get the glimpse of orgasmic, organic oneness, both inner and outer. That feeling of total unity or synergistic harmony is God. In that state, in whatever act, be it sex, you enter, it will take you beyond. In that state, in whatever act, be it sex, you enter, it will take you beyond. And then one day, when you reach the ultimate, you are transformed. Meditatively, when you enter sex out of your inner harmony, you certainly get the glimpse of organic, orgasmic oneness, both inner and outer. That feeling of total unity or synergistic harmony is God. That feeling of total unity or synergistic harmony is God. God is not a person somewhere. Instead, God is the experience of the three falling in such unity that the fourth arises. And the fourth is more than the aggregate of all the parts. Fourth is beyondness. If you dissect a flower, you will find all chemicals, the petals, stems and pollen. Maybe you can even separate the color and the fragrance too, but the flower will not be there. Remember, the colors, the petals and the fragrance is not flower or its aliveness. Even the aggregate of these is not flower. Flower is something more. That something more is expressed through the flower, color, beauty, fragrance and the aliveness that surrounds the flower. The whole is more than the sum total of the parts. It expresses through the parts, but it is more. To understand that it is more is to understand God. God is that more, that plus. It is not a question of theology. It cannot be decided by theologians or by logical argumentation. You have to feel beauty, music and dance. And ultimately you have to feel the dance in your body, mind and the soul. You have to learn to play on these three energies so that they all become an orchestra, then God is. Not that you see God. There is nothing to be seen. God is the ultimate seer, then how can you see? How can you see God? Because God is the ultimate seer, that faculty that sees. This is witnessing. Learn to melt your body, mind and soul. Find out ways when you can function as unity, as synergistic harmony. It happens many times to runners. You will not think of running as meditation, but runners sometimes have experienced a state of meditation. They are surprised because they were not looking for it. Who thinks that a runner is going to experience God? Certainly it has happened. And now running is becoming more and more a kind of meditation. The harmony between body, mind and soul can happen in running. If you have ever been a runner, enjoy running in the early morning when the air is fresh and young. Enjoy running and the whole world is awakening out of sleep. In the morning time is the most ideal time for running and experiencing something of the beyond. If you have ever been a runner, enjoy running in the early morning when the air is fresh and young. Enjoy running and the whole world is awakening out of the sleep. The birds are chirping. The horizon is getting aglowed with the light of the sun and its rays. Enjoy running as your body begins to function beautifully amidst the fresh air and everything singing around you, the birds, the breeze, the rustling of the tree leaves, the dance of the sun rays. Enjoy running when you are feeling so alive and pulsating with life force. Running will become a meditation. Walking in the evening cannot become a meditation. Running in the evening cannot become a meditation. Running in the morning can definitely become a meditation. Because the dawn is there after the night sleep. The entire cosmos is beginning to wake with the dance of the sun rays, the breeze, the chirping of the birds, and all that is there. A moment comes when the runner disappears and there is only running. The body, mind, and soul are functioning in togetherness, and suddenly an inner orgasm happens. Runners have sometimes become accidentally on the experience of the fourth dimension, Turiya. Although they will miss because they will think it is just because of running that they enjoyed the moment. Maybe it was a beautiful day, the body was healthy, and the world was beautiful, and there was just a certain mood. They will not take note of it. However, if they take note of it, a runner can more easily come close to meditation than anybody else. Jogging too can be of immense help. So too, swimming can be of immense help. So too, sex can be of immense help. Sex attracts you easily than anything else. Sex is normal and spontaneous existential bioenergy. When you enter in sex this way, singing and dancing, enjoying the chirping of the birds and all that is, then there will be tremendous movement on the surface, but deep within you will experience the immovable. This is the ultimate in sex. For the first time through sex, you will experience the eternal within. What happened to Rumi through whirling? All these things have to be transformed into meditation. Dancing, singing, walking, swimming, running, jogging, sexing, all these things have to be transformed into meditation through inner harmony, oneness, joy. Normally, what happens? People go into the act of sex in the night. Then you go to sleep and wake up late in the morning. When you run, you go for jogging. People choose any odd hour. In the evening, they are going for jogging or walk. But the joy of jogging in the morning, at the dawn, the joy of having sex at the time when the birds begin to chirp, the sun rays are on the horizon, the rustling, the breeze is there. It has a joy of its own. It transcends the baser into precious. Jogging then, running then, swimming then, all transforms you, all become the act of converting, transforming, transcending baser into precious. The cross is transformed into subtle. Only this much